الرحمن الرحیم وصلی اللہ علی النبی الکریم رب اشرح لی صدری ویسر لی امری واحلل عقدۃ من لسانی یفقہوا قولی. واٹ از ایکٹیویزم؟ ایکٹیویزم از systematic effort to achieve some specific goal. This is activism. You know, there are many types of activism. For example, media activism, judicial activism, social activism, community activism, and so on. But in fact, there are only two categories of activism. That is God-oriented activism and man-oriented activism. Prophet activism was God-oriented activism, and all other types of activism are man-oriented activism. In other words, God-oriented activism is Akhirat-oriented activism, and all other types of activism are world-oriented activism. This is the basic difference. You know, man always faces different type of problems. Man's life is full of problems. Problems are part of life. So, man-oriented activism becomes problem-oriented activism. Every time there are some problems, so people react to these problems and they become activists, human rights activists and political activists and so on. So all other activism are based on worldly affairs. Perhaps there is no exception. But prophetic model is quite different. Prophetic model is based on Akhirat. Prophet's activism was Akhirat-oriented activism. Now, let us take the examples from the Prophet of Islam. You know, Prophet of Islam, Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, was born in Mecca in 570 AD. Then, when he was 35 years old, he became seeker of truth. This is before the prophethood. So when he reached to 35 years age, he became seeker of truth. He used to visit Mount Hira. Mount Hira was 3 miles away from Mecca. So he used to visit Hira frequently and stay over there in a cave for some days. It was called Ghar Hira or Cave of Hira. So he stayed over there day and night. Then what was his activities at that time? It was not meditation, as some people believe. No, it was contemplation. That is tafakkur and tadabbur. He was a seeker, so he wanted to know what is the truth. This was a thinking process. Thinking process. Thus he lived over there up to 5 years, not continuously, but with gaps. Then when he was 40 years of age and he was in Cave of Hira, Angel Jibrail appeared. This is the first revelation. So Angel Jibril said, "O Muhammad, Iqra." So at this moment, the first surah was revealed. Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq, khalaqa al-insana min alaq. Iqra wa rabbuka al-akram, alladhi 'allama bil-qalam. This example of the Prophet is very important. This example tells us what is the beginning of a believer. The beginning is seeking, contemplation, ghaur wa tadabbur. This is the beginning. The Quran says, وَوَجَتَكَ ظَالًّا فَهَدَى. God found you a seeker, then he revealed you the guidance. So first of all, we have to be a seeker. Seeker means going to contemplation, that is ghaur wa tafakkur. After this process, we discover the truth. The discovery of truth was not only for Prophet, it is for every believer. Every believer. Iman begins from discovery. It's very important to know that Iman does not begin from the recitation of Kalima. No, that is not the beginning. Beginning is going to contemplation, going to tafakkur and tadabbur. Now I can say that going to study, Prophet used to go to Cave of Hira, Cave of Mount Hira, but now we don't need to visit any mount, any cave. Now the cave is a library. At that time, there were no books. That was pre-printing press age. But now we are living in the age of printing press, age of books, age of literatures. So now, for a seeker, library is the cave of Mount Hira. We have to contemplate in the nature, in the universe. Then we have to study the books. We have to live a life of a seeker. This is the first step in the iman, in the belief. It is wrong to believe that recitation is the beginning of iman. No. Recitation is like saying I found. And when you discover the truth, then you say La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. That is kalima of discovery. Kalima of discovery. So it is very important to understand that the life of the Prophet tell us what is the beginning of belief. Beginning of belief is seeking spirit, study, contemplation, tafakkur and tadabbur. Then what happened? When Prophet received the first revelation and he received the guidance from God, then what happened? He started his mission. So his mission was not an outcome of reaction, but outcome of discovery. Now you know all the leaders, perhaps without any exception, are production of reaction. In every situation, there are some political problem, some economic problem, social problem. So, those who react to these problems, they become leader. So, all the leaders of our present age are reactionary leaders. They are not positive leaders. When they say that I have assumed the role of leadership, it means that I assume the leadership of reaction. But this was not the case of the Prophet. Prophet's case was not a case of reaction. It was a case of discovery. A case of marifat, a case of iktishaf, a case of realization. So when he realized the truth, when he discovered the truth, he became a believer. Then he became a prophet. Then he started his mission. At the time, there was a rock outside of Mecca. It was called Safa. So this rock, that is Safa, Quraysh people used it as a platform. When they wanted to deliver some message, they stood up on that rock. And people gathered over there. Then they deliver their speech. So Prophet of Islam, instead of on Safa, he called people and they gathered over there. Then he said, God has appointed me a prophet. For what purpose? To give a message that that death is not the end. Death is only beginning of the second of the life, second part of their life. This was the message, that death is not the end of life. Death is only a new beginning, only beginning of the other life. He said, فَإِنَّهَا لَجَنَّةٌ أَبَدًا أَوْ لَنَارٌ أَبَدًا. So after death, you will enter into a new world. And in that world, you will be rewarded paradise, or you will be punished with hell. See, in that world, there is either the hell or the paradise. So you have to be very, very cautious in your life. This life is a testing period. The one who stands on test, he will be rewarded. The one who failed in this test, he will be punished. This was the message. Then what happened? In the audience, there was Abu Lahab. He was Prophet's uncle. So, when Prophet ended his speech, it was a very short speech. It was not a long speech. Abu Lahab said, Tamballaka sa'ir al-yawm ama jamatana illa lihaza. Curse on you. Have you invited us just for this trivial message? This was the reaction of Abu Lahab. Because Abu Lahab was a man whose thinking was worldly oriented thinking. Abu Lahab was a trader of that time. So his thinking was world-oriented thinking or dunya-oriented thinking. And Prophet's message was akhirat-oriented message. So if he failed to understand the importance of this kind of message, he was aware only worldly values, worldly interests, worldly things. But in the Prophet's message, there was no such such things. It was a completely a message that was akhirat-oriented message. So Abu Lahab failed to understand the importance of this message. But Prophet never changed his stand. He continued his message, continued his mission. Here I will give you an example that Prophet's message was not worldly, not dunya-oriented message, not world-oriented message. It was completely an akhirat-oriented message. So you know, Makkah was situated in the desert. There was a great desert, and Makkah was situated in that desert. So there was no water. There was no irrigation. And when there was no irrigation, there was no agriculture, no horticulture, no greenery. So Meccan people said to the Prophet, let us find some way to irrigate our land. Let us find out some way to irrigate our land so that we can grow here agriculture and horticulture. Apparently, it was a genuine demand. But Prophet said, ماں بحاذا بوئس تو الیکم. I was not sent to you for this purpose. I was not sent to you for this purpose. The purpose of my prophethood is to show you the way of success of the akhirat. Success is akhirat success. He said, "Allahumma la aisha illa aisha al-akhirah." Success is akhirat success. So he said that I was not sent for this kind of task, although it was genuine, there was no wrong, but this was not the prophet's mission, this was not the prophet's duty. Prophet's duty was to make people aware of the creation plan of God. People were unaware what is the creation, who is the creator, what the creation mission, what is the plan of creator, why we are here, what is the purpose of our life, what is before death and what is after death. All these questions were akhirat oriented questions, and prophet was sent for this purpose, to make people aware of these questions. So he strictly followed this path. He never deviated from this path. So this was the prophet's model. His life started from seeking, from contemplation. Then after discovery, when he realized the truth, he devoted his life in what I can say akhirat oriented mission, not dunya oriented mission. He devoted his life completely in akhirat oriented mission. Then prophet lived in Mecca up to 13 years. All these 30 years, or the 13 years, he was busy in his mission. There are some other problems, not only in terms of economy, but also in terms of religion also. For example, there was, you know, in Mecca, there was Kaaba. Kaaba was built by Prophet Ibrahim. So Kaaba was a house of Tawheed built by Prophet Ibrahim. But at that time, when Prophet was born over there, Quraysh people were custodian of Kaaba. So, and they were mushrik at that time, idol worshippers. So they placed 370 idols in the Kaaba. These idols were idols of the tribes. So to attract all the tribes of Arabia, they placed these idols. So it was quite against the mission of the Prophet of Islam, because Prophet of Islam's mission was to revive the deen of Ibrahim, to disseminate the message of Tawheed. And that house, at that center, Kaaba was center of Tawheed. In modern language, we can say that Kaaba was center of Tawheed. But Prophet never tried to destroy these idols. Why? Because there was a risk of fighting, risk of conflict, risk of war. So he avoided. He tolerated those idols. He wanted to run his mission smoothly, without any problem, peacefully. So he accepted unilateral adjustment. It was a kind of a unilateral adjustment. And it worked. Due to this unilateral adjustment, he was able to disseminate the message of Tawheed in Mecca. Instead going to any kind of conflict, he make dua. For example, he said in a dua, Allahumma aizil islam bi ahdil umrain. There were two persons, both were Umar, Amr ibn Hisham and Umar ibn Khattab. These two persons were very, very intelligent persons. Both were leader of that time. So Prophet make dua, O God, give them tawfiq that they may accept my mission. So his dua was fulfilled for Umar ibn Khattab. He accepted Islam. So this was his method in Mecca. He was engaged in his mission with observing peace completely. He adopted peaceful method in complete sense of the word. And where there were problems, he tried to make dua. So peaceful method and dua, this was the two-point formula for him at that time. His whole mission was based on these two things, dua and peaceful preaching of his mission. So this was the prophetic model. He never engaged in politics. Even at that time, at some juncture, they offered him political leadership. They said that in turidu mulkan malaknaka alaina, if you want leadership, we will give you leadership, political leadership. If you want political leadership, we will give you leadership. But he said, no. Ma atribul mulka alaykum. It is not my aim, it is not my ambition to become a ruler, to become a political leader. It is not my goal, it is not my target, it is not my ambitions. So Prophet of Islam was according to Quran, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Prophet of Islam was a good example. He was best model for all the believers. And what was his model? He started his life from contemplation. And when he discovered the truth, he started his mission by following peaceful method. He tolerated all those evils that were widespread in Mecca. He never tried to go to conflict. He never tried to go to war. So thus he preached his mission in Medina. And it worked. He was able to find all those people. All those people who were pious, who were seeker, who were honest, they came to his fold. They accepted Islam. All those people who we call Ajilla Sahaba, that is big Sahaba, great companions, they accepted Islam in this period, in during Makkah period, like Hazrat Abu Bakr, like Hazrat Umar, like Hazrat Usman, like Hazrat Ali, like Hazrat Abu Ubaidah ibn Jarrah, and so many other people. So this was the outcome of peaceful method. This was the outcome of following complete avoidance. Then Prophet, when Quraysh saw that people are accepting Muhammad's religion and it is best of our people are going to his fold, so they turned hostile. They wanted to wage a war against Muhammad and his companions. Then Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam decided to migrate Mecca. Although there, at that time there were more than 100 Sahaba with him, and all these Sahaba were very, very loyal to him, but he never tried to go to war. He decided to leave Mecca. So he migrated from Mecca and he settled in Medina. This event is called Hijra in Islamic history. Then when he reached Medina, what message he gave to them? In the first sermon he delivered in Medina, he said, أيها الناس اتقوا النار ولو بشق تمرة. This was the first message he gave to Medina people. It means that, O people of Medina, save yourself from hellfire at any cost. اتقوا النار ولو بشق تمرة. O people of Medina, save yourself from hellfire at any cost. Again, you can see that prophets, what was the prophet's concern? His concern was not anything. His concern was not to gain political power, to gain some worldly interest. No. His concern was to make people aware of the creation plan of God. His concern was to make people aware about hell and paradise. So this was his message. So his message was one and the same in Mecca and Medina. There was no change in his message. No change in the message. So it is very, very important to understand. In our age, we see there are so many leaders, but all these leaders are outcome of reaction. And they are engaged in worldly affairs, in economic affairs, in political affairs, in community affairs, in social affairs. All the leaders are engaged in these affairs because they are creation of reaction. When a leader is outcome of a reaction, then it is but natural that he will engage himself in worldly affairs. But this is not a prophetic model. Prophetic model is, first of all, you have to study. You have to understand what is the truth. Then after discovery, after realization, you can start your mission. Your mission, if your mission is outcome of reaction, then it is not prophetic method. It is worldly method. This difference is very important. This difference is very important. Then there were some wars between prophets and his opponents. So some people say that Muhammad was the prophet of war. But it is sheer generalization. You have to save yourself from generalization. You know, in every rule there are some exceptions. So it is not right to generalize the exceptions. The whole life of the prophet was peaceful life. He always observed peace, tolerance, and love and compassion. These were the values on which his mission was based. But due to some aggression, sometime, namely 3 times, he was compelled to go to war. Those wars were defensive wars. I can say that in Islam, peace is the rule and war is a rare exception. In Islam, peace is the rule and war is a rare exception. And again, I would like to say that in Islam, there is only one kind of war, that is defensive war. Other than defensive war, there is no war at all in Islam. Even at the time of aggression, you have to try to avoid the war. You have to settle the matter. You have to go to negotiation. You have to start a dialogue. And even if all these efforts fail, then compulsively you will go to war. Otherwise not. And again, I would like to say that present kind of jihad is not, present kind of jihad are not Islamic jihad. Because jihad is a prerogative of Jihad in the sense of qatal is a prerogative of a state. No individual, no private organization has right to go to war. Other than a state, every individual or organization have only one option, that is peaceful method. There is no other option for non-political people. So this was the prophetic method, prophetic model. And anyone who want to get salvation, he must follow the prophet's method, prophet's model. Without following the prophet's model, no one can find the salvation by God or his blessing. Then I will give you some examples of God-oriented life. What is God-oriented life? As I have earlier said, that prophet's method is God-oriented method. So what is God-oriented life? It begins from Iman, that is belief. Iman Billah, in him, to believe in God. Then Ibadah, that is worship of God. Then Dua, and all those form of Ibadah, which is prescribed in the Hadith and Quran. Then there is the Hadith, Takhallaqu bi akhlaqillah. Adopt the character of God. Adopt divine character. What is divine character? Divine character is demonstrated in this world. In everything there you can find this demonstration. For example, let us take the sun. Sun gives you light and heat, but free of cost. Every day and night he supplies to it supplies light and heat. But all these things are free of cost. So it means that you must live as a giver person in the society, not a taker person. Sun is a giver sun, it is not a taker sun. So this is one example of divine character. You have to live as a giver person, not as a taker person. Then you know, we inhale oxygen and we exhale carbon. So there is a very, very interesting exchange between us and all these trees. Trees inhale our carbon and exhale oxygen. Then we find oxygen and we inhale oxygen and exhale carbon. These are exchange. It means that carbon is a harmful gas and oxygen is very, very useful gas. So it means that in this world we have to live with this kind of positivity. this kind of positivity. We have to give people positive message, not negative message. Our behavior to others will be positive behavior or not negative behavior. We have to live in this world, in our society, as a giver member or not as a taker member. This is divine character. So in everything there are examples. The whole nature, the whole world is a demonstration of divine character. This is God-oriented life. We cannot see God, but we can see God's creation. We cannot see God, but we can see God's creation every moment, every day and night. For example, there are numerous stars in the space, numerous stars. All are in moving state. But there is no crash, no conflict. This is also an example. We have to live in this world according to this pattern. We are allowed to move, we are allowed to be active, but with one condition, that we have to keep ourselves. We have to be peaceful. We have to avoid all kind of conflict. We are free to move, but we are not free to go to clash, to conflict. This divine character. So Prophet was sent to this earth for this purpose, to tell us what is the God-oriented life, what is the God-oriented thinking, what is the God-oriented behavior. He was sent for this purpose. So one who wants to revive the prophetic mission, he must follow this pattern. Everyone who wants to revive the prophetic mission, he must follow this pattern. There is no other pattern. If you adopt any other pattern, then you cannot say that you are reviving the prophet's mission. So it is very important to know that Prophet not only gave us the message of the book of Quran, but also he is a complete model, complete example. لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ. Then the whole Quran and Hadith if you read the Quran and if you read the Hadith, you will find what is the God-oriented life. For example, let us the first verse of the Quran, Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. All praise be to the Lord of the universe. All praise be to Lord of the universe. Now what is praise? What is praise? Praise is not simply lip service. No. It is oceanic acknowledgement. Hamd means oceanic acknowledgement to God. When you go to contemplation, when you remember God's blessing, when you think about the vastness of the universe, when you think about all those things that is called life support system. So when you remember God's blessing, universal blessing, so you fill with thrill. You are so thrilled that you feel that I have no word to express my expression, my feeling. So it is Hamd is not simply a lip service. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen is an oceanic acknowledgement to God. So this is God-oriented life. The Prophet of Islam gave us this message that man was created by God. All those things we enjoy in this world are God's blessing. Every moment we are blessed with God, with God's blessings. So we have to acknowledge these blessings. Then there is a verse, Ashaddu Hubban Lillah. You know, love is the very deep feeling of a man. Greatest, I think the deepest feeling of our heart is love. So you have to love God only God. Today I was listening on the radio. You know, it is Father's Day. So a lady was speaking in the radio. His father expired before 20 years ago. So that lady was saying that, I love so much my father that I never write my father, late father. I try to believe that he is with me. Every time my father is with me. He said that I never write for my father as late father, because I try to believe that father is with me. I think that this kind of feeling is a wrong attribution. This feeling is required for God, not for father. Not for father. Now when father is no more, he cannot help you anything. He cannot help you. He cannot give you anything. Only, but God is alive. God can give you everything. And he is giving all the things every day and night. So God is your helper, not your father. After death, he is no more. He is nothing. But he falsely tries to believe that God is, that father is with me. So he says that I never write late father. So love is the deepest sentiment in every human being. And this sentiment we have to give to God. We have to love God more than anything. اشد حب للہ. دس از دا مین آسپیکٹ آف گاڈ اورینٹڈ لائف, گاڈ اورینٹڈ تھنکنگ, گاڈ اورینٹڈ مائنڈ. تو لو از فار گاڈ, لو از فار گاڈ. گاڈ کریٹڈ اس, گاڈ گیو اس آل دوز لائف سپورٹ سسٹم, گاڈ ہیز given us all those blessings. So it is God's right. Love is God's right. We have to love God with all our heart. We have to love God with all our heart, with our mind, with all our soul. اشد حب للہ means we have to love God with all our soul, with all our heart, with all our mind. This is اشد حب للہ. So in every aspect we have to adopt divine character. We have to live a life that is God oriented life, and we have to follow the prophet's model, prophet's examples. Then we'll be accepted as believer, then we'll be rewarded paradise. So it is very important to contemplate and to understand all these things. May God bless you. اقول قولی هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم اجمعين.
This question is from Mr. Faik from Pennsylvania. Marana, his question is, Prophet made dua that Allah gives strength to Islam by one of the Umars. Allah chose Umar Khattab. Now the question is, does dua change the life, or is it predestined, or is it pre-known to Allah?
According to my knowledge, dua itself cannot change the personality. If somebody is seeker, then dua will be effective. If you are not a seeker, then dua will not be effective. So Prophet of Islam prayed for two persons, Amr ibn Hisham and Amr ibn Abdul-Tab. So according to the historical account, Amr ibn Hisham was not a seeker. He was a very arrogant person. One who is arrogant person is not a seeker. Seeking and arrogance both cannot go to. So it is a, so Amr ibn Hisham was an arrogant person, so he was not a seeker. But Umar ibn Khattab was not arrogant person. He was a modest person. So he was a seeker. So dua is very powerful method in the way of dua work. But dua will work only with those persons who are seeker. Those who are not seeker, you cannot change them simply by making dua.
This question is from Miss Sheba Khwaja from Delhi. Is coercing someone into observing hijab also a form of violence?
Yes, it is violence. You can persuade, you cannot coerce. In Islam, there is no coercion. In Islam, there is only persuasion. So persuasion is allowed, but coercion is not allowed. There is a very clear verse in the Quran, La ikraha fi ddeen. There is no question in the religion. La ikraha fi ddeen. There is no compulsion or no question in the religion. So in the religion or in Islam, only persuasion is allowed and not the question.
This question is from Mr. Idris from Delhi. Maulana, kindly give some examples from Prophet's life on to be a giving member of society rather than to be a taker of the society.
By giving, I don't mean simply giving of money. Greatest giving is that you devote yourself in this mission without asking any payment. So this is a sacrifice, and this sacrifice is the greatest giving. Prophet of Islam used to give money also, but I think that greatest giving of the Prophet was his dawah work and his motto was La asalukum alayhi min ajr. I don't want any return from you. So Prophet of Islam adopted patience, complete patience, tolerance. He was always engaged in dua, and he performed his mission without any kind of return. So this was the greatest giving on the part of the Prophet of Islam. Also, he was a great generous person. He gave money and other things to other people. But according to my experience, I can say that greatest giving is dawah work, selfless dawah work. Greatest giving is selfless dawah work.
His second question is, how should one avoid conflict even if one is provoked?
Keep patience, very simple. Learn the emotion management. Learn the art of emotion management. It is very simple. You have to learn the art of emotion management. You have to keep patience for the sake of God. For the sake of God. Because you will be rewarded. There is a verse in the Quran, Innama yuwaffas sabirun ajrahum bighair hisab. It means that sabr, people of sabr will be rewarded, unlimited reward. Unlimited reward. God has promised to those people who keep patience, unlimited reward. So you have to keep patience at that time for the sake of God, for the sake of God, for the sake of unlimited reward. I think it is very, very, at least for me, it is very, 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 very easy. I think it is very easy. So I would like to say that you have to learn the art of emotion management. It is a matter of emotions. What is provocation? Provocation is a matter of emotion. So you have to learn the art of emotion management. This is a very, very simple formula.
This question is from Miss Vinny Malhotra from Delhi. Why is it, Maulana, that our thankfulness to God does not last long, just a slight trouble, and we lose that peaceful state and start complaining?
I think it is due to unawareness. People don't know the value of gratefulness. They don't know the value of thanksgiving. So you have to enhance your study. You have to go to contemplation. According to my experience, it is due to unawareness. People don't know the value of hamd or thanksgiving. So this is the reason. According to my experience, this is the reason.
This question is from Mr. Shafiq Bandagi from Michigan. He's written, Maulana, excuse me for my long question, but it is essential that this be addressed. So I appreciate if you could please answer this. I am a disciple of yours for last 32 years and have been reading your books and following your lectures. I was heavily involved in Dawa among Hindu community in India, and now I am actively doing here in USA. My question is about the Dawa methodology. Here is what I am following. I need your experts' advice and guidance in this regard. I work through our local masjid called Muslim Unity Center in Bloomfield Hills, Michigan. I go to local colleges, malls, fairs, and exhibitions and set up dawah tables and give away free copies of Quran and pamphlets about Islam while displaying the posters by discoverislam.com. We also conduct open houses at our mosque and invite the non-Muslim neighbors through advertisements in local media. On a personal level, I use every opportunity to give dawah to my colleagues, friends, and neighbors. I grab the opportunities like births, promotions, weddings, or deaths to give them copies of Quran and audio CDs. The challenges I am facing are as under. Number one, I am not able to find courage to directly invite my non-Muslim friends to Islam, which was actually the methodology of prophets and companions. I have fear of being ridiculed, rejected, and hated. All I am doing right now is either giving plain information on Islam or insinuating at the benefits of Islam through sugar-coated messages. Second problem is the lack of dawah material that can address the non-Muslims in their own language and psyche. What we have right now is bulky and boring essays written using a lot of Muslim jargon that anybody hardly reads past a couple of introductory lines. I think handing out copies of Quran translation or bulky books on Islam and Prophet is a very effective and efficient way of dawah. The message should be brief, effective, and gripping written in their own languages, like what the Christian evangelists have developed. We need help in developing such material. Also, giving away audio material is much effective than printed booklets, as people have very less time to sit and read. They will at least listen to audio while doing other activities. Thirdly, I get hardly any support and help from our Muslim communities. Dawah is way, way down in their priority list, including the learned and the educated alims. Dawah is not a single person's job. We need lot more trained volunteers to answer questions, distribute material, and follow up post-dawah activity. How can we motivate and inspire our community to support this noble mission? Is arguing and debating with non-Muslims a good form of dawah? Kindly guide.
The first question, about first question, I would like to say that direct invitation is not necessary. Now we are living in the age of literature. The literature is enough. You have to spread the literature, and that is enough. No direct invitation is necessary. The second question, about the second question, that is about literature. I would like to say that why you are using those literature? We have published 200 books that is very useful for non-Muslims. These are in every kind of two pages pamphlet, 3 page pamphlet, and 10 page pamphlet. You can use all these materials. We are using here in India, and we can say that we are very successful. Everyone reads easily. So you have to use this literature, and also you have to read our translation of the Quran. We have produced so much literature that is enough to do the work in everywhere, in America, in Europe, in India, everywhere in the world. So I would like to suggest that you have to use those literature which are printed from our institution. Then about the third question, I would like to say that there is a verse in the Quran, لَا يُكَلِّفُ اللَّهُ نَفْسًا إِلَّا أَوْسَعَ. Yani you are mukallaf according to your capacity. So you have to do the hour according to your own capacity. More than capacity is not your responsibility. We are doing on this pattern. Myself and my colleague are doing the hour according to their capacity. So you have to do the hour according to your capacity. And where you are, you have, and where you, where we, you find that you have no capacity, no sources, so you have make dua. So it is 2-point formula. Do the work according to your capacity, and what is beyond your capacity, to do dua. This is 2-point formula.
This question is from Ms. Nagma Siddiqui from Delhi. Maulana, you said that dua will only work for a seeker. What is the right way of doing dua?
I don't think that there is any right way of dua. You have to make dua every time, because dua is ibadah. Dua is ibadah. So you have to do dua in every matter, about every person. As far as the Isra is concerned, or acceptance of truth is concerned, it depends upon seeking spirit. You have to make dua every time. But as far as the other person is concerned, if he is a seeker, then it will be benefited for him, otherwise not.
This question is from Dr. Farida Khanam from Delhi. How to rise above our biases, complexes and prejudices? Why is it that the majority of people fail to rise above their complexes?
I think that they lack muhasaba. Muhasaba means introspection. Very few people do muhasaba. Although they perform namaz, they fast roza, they do hajj, but very few people, I can say, that they do muhasaba, that is introspection. So it requires great introspection, but I can say, but merciless introspection. Without merciless introspection, you cannot achieve this goal. So I advise to every member of this, of our team, to do muhasaba, that is introspection. Muhasaba is the only way of spiritual development. Without muhasaba or introspection, there is no spiritual development.
Maulana, is there any example from Prophet's life that after attaining prophethood, Prophet was involved in both community work as well as dawah work? Or is it that Prophet focused only his energies towards dawah work? What should Muslims of in today's time do? Should they focus only on dawah work, or can they do both?
There is no example in the life of the Prophet. He was never engaged in what is called community work or milli work, not at all. Every time he was engaged in dawah work. So I would like to say that at least the members of our team adopt this model. You have to spend your time, your energy, your money completely on dawah work. This is the model of the Prophet of Islam. You know, Prophet of Islam was engaged in a community work that was Hilful Fuzul. It is very interesting to know that before prophethood, he was a member of this organization. It was Hilful Fuzul. It was a kind of community work or social work. So he was a member of this organization. But after prophethood, he left that organization. After prophethood, he never attended the meeting of that social work. So as far as the Prophet's model is concerned, he never engaged in any kind of community work or social work. That is model of Mother Teresa. He is not model of the Prophet. I cannot find any example in the Prophet's life. He was engaged, he spent all of his life, all of his energy in this work, that is the hour. And he was so engaged that God Himself said, لَلَّكَ بَاخَوْ نَفْسَكَ أَلَّا يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. Perhaps you will kill you in this dawah work. He was so engaged in this dawah work that God Himself said, لَلَّكَ بَاخُوا نَفْسَكَ أَلَّا يَكُونُوا مُؤْمِنِينَ. So, according to my study, my knowledge, this is the only example of the Prophet of Islam. We have to do the work. we have to spend all our energy, all our money, all our time in this work, that is our work.
This question is from Mr. Ramesh from Delhi. Maulana, how to detach oneself from the family love?
Family love in some sense is natural. But the sentiment of love is for God, it's not for family. You have to discover this fact, because there's a verse in the Quran, yom yafirul maru min akhi wa ummihi wa abi wa sahibatihi wa bani. After death, everything after death, you are detached from everything. There is no family, nothing. You will be alone just after death. But God is every time with you. God's love is an eternal. God's love has eternal value. But family love is simply has only worldly value. It will persist only in this in the pre-death period. After death period, there is no family love. Family love will persist only in pre-death period. In the post-death period, there is no family love. It's very clear in the Quran. So you have to be realist.
This question is from Mr. Khaja Kalimuddin from Pennsylvania. We see Prophet Muhammad in different roles. For example, as a conveyor of the truth, a ruler, a family man, a philanthropist, etc. Therefore, we see people taking up one of these different roles and making it their life's mission. Now my question is to you, Maulana Sahab, why do you lay importance upon only the role of conveying the message of the truth of the Prophet as opposed to other roles?
According to my study, all other roles were secondary. The primary role was only dawah work. I have no doubt that Prophet's primary role was only dawah work. And all other works, all other relationship and all other things were only secondary. If you want detail, I can give you detail, inshallah, in my magazine.
This question is from Mr. Faik from Pennsylvania. As part of our iman, we believe in destiny. Maulana, is everything predestined? Like the marriage, that is you marry only with the person that you were destined to marry, regardless of the prayers or efforts one makes in this regard, or the children who would come into this world, or risk. Kindly comment.
This kind of concept of destiny is not correct. Destiny, it means that we are living in a world, we use all those infrastructures provided by God For example, we cannot live without oxygen, you cannot live without sunlight, you can't live without planet Earth. This is destiny. But as far as our action is concerned, it is completely upon our free will. We are free for our actions. We are free for our actions. We are free for our speech. But as far as the infrastructure is concerned, we are not free. We cannot find another planet. We cannot find another sun. We cannot find another air. We cannot find another source of oxygen. In this sense, there is destiny. But as far as the will is concerned, we are free. Completely free. There is no compulsion at all. So this is called in Ilm Kalam Wasatiyya. Wasatiyya. Wasatiyya means 50% we are free and 50% we are determined. In terms of infrastructure, everything is determined. But in terms of free will, we are completely free. There is no compulsion at all.
His other question is, will only the Muslims go to heaven? What will happen to good people of other faiths who do not do shirk and believe in one God and lead a humanitarian life?
It is wrong to believe that all those so-called Muslims will go to paradise. It is wishful thinking. It is wishful thinking. And born Muslim, paradise is not for born Muslims. No. Paradise is for those who discover God, who realize all those truths by their account, and that they adopt the system of ibadah, they adopt the divine character, who do dawah work. So those who adopt all these practices sincerely, they will go to paradise. Simply, one who was born in a Muslim family is not enough for going to paradise. This belief is completely wrong.
Murana, he also wants to know that whether the prophets were born or were they chosen by Allah?
Only God knows. I don't know what is the exact answer.
This question is from Mr. Khaja Kalimuddin from Pennsylvania. Can anyone being unaware of the existence of the prophets reach to the same realization of God if one undergoes a long period of contemplation, and will he be granted salvation in the hereafter?
Please repeat.
Can anyone being unaware of the existence of the prophets reach to the same realization of God if one undergoes a long period of contemplation, and will he be granted salvation in the hereafter?
According to my experience, without the guidance of the prophet, no one can discover the truth in complete sense of the word. It is not possible. So, prophetic guidance is necessary. Now, if anyone is completely unaware of the prophet, although it is not possible, nowadays, everyone knows about the prophet. Everyone knows about the Quran. So I think it is practically not possible to be unaware in complete sense of the word. So I don't believe that, especially in these days, there is a person who is completely unaware. So one who knows about the Quran, one who knows about the Prophet. It is his duty to read the Quran, to read the Prophet's life. It is his duty. Otherwise, he will be accountable before God. You know, recently, American President Obama had delivered a speech from Cairo. It was a 5,800-word speech. And this speech was well arranged. And almost all the world listened to this speech. In this speech, he repeatedly referred to Quranic verses and also other teachings of Islam. So I think that in the age of communication, it is impossible that there is anyone who is completely unaware of the Prophet or the Quran. I don't think that it is possible.